myself Syam Kamal. I am assistant professor in department of electrical engineering IIT BHU. Today I am going to start the first class of optimal control. So course code is EE564, and in today's lecture we are going to see that how basically one can formulate the optimal control problem. So let us start the today's lecture with one of the very famous axioms. And axioms means some kind of statement or some kind of thought that is given by people and we are blindly accepting it. So without proving, we are basically accepting it. So that famous axioms tells us that a problem well put is a problem half solved. So what is main meaning of this axioms? That if you are going to solve some problem, first try to identify the all important part of the problem, and if you are able to understand the each and every part of the problem, then it is very easy to solve that problem. So before starting the today's lecture, I am going to fix the some definition, and one of the most important definition is related to the system. So in this course, whenever I am going to talk about the system, the meaning of that particular system is like this. I am going to basically take that a physical system, which is basically abstracted by some class of mathematical model. So here I have system. So either you can assume this as a physical system or some kind of abstract mathematical model. Model may be in form of set of differential equation, some class of stochastic differential equation, or some kind of partial differential equation. But for simplicity of the discussion, I am going to consider only those class of system which is represented by the differential equation. And we are assuming that this system has certain kind of input, and basically this input is either some kind of real number or some kind of vector in form of real number. Similarly, whenever we are talking about the output, again I am assuming that whatever output, that is some kind of real number or some kind of vector, that is considered as a real number. So basically, if you see any system that is mapping from some set of real number to some set of real number, and this system is somehow satisfy the property of function, so what we are assuming that for a specific input, this output is always unique. So uniqueness is one of the most important factor here. And here in this particular course, I am going to talk about the dynamical system. So dynamical system, I am going to represent using set of differential equation. It means that in order to predict the future behavior of the system, I have to know the input, and after that I have to know some kind of history, and that history is basically captured using the notion of state. So basically a state is some kind of physical variable that is going to carry the all information till the starting time of experiment. So if I know that information, I know the input, then I am assuming that I can predict the output uniquely. That is very, very important, uniquely. So that is the general meaning. Now let us come to the objective of control design. Here you can see that system, I have either this is some kind of physical system or some kind of mathematical system. Mathematical system means I have certain set of mathematical differential equation, and using that mathematical differential equation, I am representing some class of system. And after that, I know the objective, I know the output. Now, problem is that how to design this input in some kind of autonomous way such that this input will satisfy whatever specification that is given by user. That is the main important point. So, first step of any control design is to represent that physical system with set of some kind of mathematical model. Because most of time, whenever we are thinking about new system, either that is not available to us or it is very costly to handle that kind of system. For example, if you are working on nuclear reactor, then I cannot tell government that set one nuclear reactor inside IIT BHU and I will work on that. So that is very difficult situation. Due to that reason, what we are telling that I am going to create some kind of virtual nuclear reactor plant inside IIT BHU, and after that I am going to work on that. And how to do that? Mathematics is going to help us. So I am going to represent that particular system by set of differential equation. So basically, I am going to represent system like this, x dot x. X is the physical variable. I will tell you more about this physical variable in the next part of this lecture. And after that, I have told you that whenever we are talking about system, that represents some kind of function. And after that, this is function of, might be explicit function of time, explicit function of x. Here, whenever I am writing x, it means that somehow time is hidden here or implicit here. And after that, I have ut, that is control input. And I have already told you that whatever ut I am going to consider, that basically is some kind of real number. So I am assuming that this real number, and if I have just one input, then I have one real number. Otherwise, it is in form of vector. So I am assuming that this belongs to Rm. It means that I have certain kind of things like this, and after that I have u1, u2, u3 and u up to um. So this is real number, this is real number, so everything as a real number. Similarly, if I see the output, so I am assuming that here output is nothing but all state variable. Otherwise, in every specific problem, you are able to see that output y is defined as a h, and sometime this is function of time, xt, and again ut. In some control problem, y is just function of xt, means a state also. So for simplicity, I am assuming that whatever output I am going to consider, that is only function of the state. In this particular problem, I am going to assume that my physical variable xt belongs to Rn. So I have n number of physical variable, and after that I am assuming that y belongs to Rp. So I have p number of output. So this is the complete specification of problem, and after that I have told you that this f is function. So I am going to mathematically, I am going to write like this f, and here you can see that first variable is time. So I am going to just talk about the time as a real number. So by r positive means I am going to assume that time is starting from 0 and only move in the positive direction. And after that, you can see that second here, f is depending on three variable. So, and all are ordered variable. So after that xt, and I have already assumed that is rn. And after that another ut, I have assumed that is rm. And that map to again x dot, so dimension of x is rn, so this is also rn. So mathematically I have defined now everything, that I have certain kind of system, that system is represented by this kind of differential equation. And after that I am assuming that when I have started the experiment, at that time I know the initial condition of a state. That is very, very important. And this initial condition is nothing but that carry the all information of the past. After that I have input and I have output. So this is the representation of the system. So let us try to see that how basically this particular mathematical representation is related to some kind of practical problem. So this is one of the very simple problem. So I have one car, and basically initially that car is in rest. And after that, what we are going to assume that this car has two function. So I can actually able to accelerate this car or de-accelerate this car. And what is my objective? Objective is to move from this point to this point. Suppose this point is E. So, and D is the distance which is changing with respect to time. I am assuming that for simplicity, this car is moving on this particular line. So here you can see that whenever I am assuming this any car, so that has mass, I am assuming that mass of this particular car is unity. So from this particular physical system is my car, and I have to do certain kind of experiment, or experiment is like that. I know that initially this car is on rest. So here position as well as velocity of this car equal to zero. Now I have to define some kind of profile of acceleration and deacceleration such that this car will start from here and that is going to stop here. So I know the output. What is my output? I have to move from here to here. What is a state involved here? If you see this car, then two things are changing. One is position, another is velocity. So these two quantity is interpreted as the state. So it means that x contain two quantity, one is position and one is velocity. Both position and velocity I am going to assume that is measured as a real number, and output I have to travel this distance, and that is again a real number. So now I have to design the profile of acceleration and deacceleration, that is the control problem, such that one can move from here to 0 to E. So let us try to come the abstraction. And why abstraction is needed? I have already told you that most of time, whenever we are talking about physical system, that is not easily available. So mathematics provide us a platform where even if I have no system, but I can build that system using set of mathematical differential equation, and after that I can work on it. One more important point here I am going to highlight. You can see that in the above example, or in this particular abstraction, I am assuming some kind of system. I have certain kind of input and I have to achieve certain kind of output. And I have already told you that whatever input output pair, so for particular input, output should be unique. That is very, very important. So system represents some kind of function. So if I have input and output and I have to correlate input and output, then there exist infinite many way to establish relation between input and output. because system is always satisfy the property of function. So I have made infinite many choice, and due to that reason, whenever we have certain kind of physical system and we try to do mathematical model of that system, so I have infinite many way. So now if I have infinite possibility, then sometime it is useful for us, sometime it is also very difficult to do computation, that which one I have to select. So one of the guidelines of control design that try to take the mathematical model which is not very much complicated, otherwise you have to do lot of computation or sometime analysis is very very difficult. So due to that reason, control people most of time try to select model as simple as possible. So let us try to see the mathematical model of this particular system. So for this car, and you all are aware that whenever position and velocity changing, then I can apply the Newton's law. So I am going to apply Newton's second law, and after applying the Newton's second law, I will get this kind of mathematical representation. So basically dt is changing, so m I have already assumed that as a unity, and due to that reason, these two things alpha and beta, that is basically the acceleration, and you know that if I differentiate the position, then that is velocity. If you differentiate the velocity, then I can get the acceleration, and acceleration contains two things. I am talking about acceleration, I am talking about the deacceleration. So I have two different function, and due to that reason I am telling that acceleration is given by alpha t plus beta t. Now what I have to do, that this particular differential equation is second order differential equation. So sometime what happens, that here if I have second order differential equation, I know dt as a position, then I can tell that d dot as a velocity, d double dot as a acceleration. But suppose in some problem, if d triple dot comes into picture, then I can define okay d triple dot as a jerk. But if d 4 dot comes into picture, then how to define? So if something is represented by higher order differential equation, sometime it is very difficult to give some kind of physical meaning. And due to that reason, people are doing some kind of representation that is called state space representation. And in this representation, people are trying to represent same system using set of first order differential equation. So we are going to follow same way. And this is one of the important topic of modern control system, that how to represent system into a state space representation. And I hope that you all are already well aware about this. Even if you are not knowing, please do not worry. So what I am going to assume, that x1 as a dt and x2 as a d dot t. So in this particular problem, I am going to assume position as a x1 and velocity as a x2. And after that, I have acceleration. So acceleration I am going to represent by u1, and deacceleration I am going to represent by ut. And after that, in this particular coordinate frame, you can see that this second order differential equation is now converted into first order set of first order differential equation. So this is the set of first order differential equation. So in this differential equation, you can clearly able to see that basically x1 as a position and x2 as a velocity. So both physical variable, position and velocity, is involved here. And due to that reason, now I can also able to write this particular equation like this. Xt is certain kind of vector, that is x1t, and after that this as a x2t. And here I have already told you that x1 position belongs to real number, and x2 belongs to again real number, and due to that reason people are writing this, that belongs to R2, like this. So xt belongs, this symbol is called belongs in set theoretical notion, and this is real number. Real number means this line from minus infinity to plus infinity. So every data x1, x2 are going to belong to this. So this is the representation. Slowly you have to learn the representation also. So in matrix way, I can represent this system like this. So this is pretty easy. X is x1, x2. And u here, I'm assuming u is nothing but u1 plus ut. So u1 plus u2 like that. Or you can assume again, here multiplication is like this. 0, 0. So basically, ut, if you represent like u1 and ut, u2, and again this belongs to R2. So like that, if you couple everything, then this kind of representation comes into picture. So I think that you are able to understand till now. Now let us try to understand one more thing. So what is one of the most important thing, that whenever you have physical system, so you can apply any kind of fundamental law such that you can represent that system using set of differential equation. And most efficient way to represent system with set of first order differential equation, and that is called mathematical modeling. So those who are not aware about mathematical modeling, so I have already recorded the lecture of mathematical modeling, and course name is Modern Control Engineering, and that is available on YouTube. So please check it. After that, now let us come to the second one. So now I can able to understand that a state is somehow related to the physical quantity. And what is meaning, more deeper meaning of a state, that is carrying the energy or carrying some kind of information of the system. Now let us try to understand the control. So what happens, suppose that if I have to move that car from this point T0 to from 0 to E, and X represent the state. So here you can see that X is the vector, and X represent both the position and velocity, and I have time T0 to TF. So in this particular time T0 to TF, what happens? You can see that a state is changing from here to here, and this is called a state trajectory. And who is responsible to change this state trajectory? Here I am giving some kind of control input. So basically, control history or control input, a history of control input values during the interval T0 to TF is defined by U and called a control history or simply a control. And I have already told you in previous example that UT is U1 plus U1 and U2, and that belongs to R2. Now let us come to the another important concept, that is called state trajectory. So history of state values is in interval T0 to TF is called a state trajectory and denoted by X. So sometime we are going to tell that as a state trajectory, sometime that as a trajectory, sometime as a function, all are actually the same. After that, now this is the representation of the physical system car, and I have to move car from one point to another point. Now let us try to understand that whenever I have car, then what kind of physical constraint that comes into picture? Because obviously, if you select the car, then every car has certain kind of engine, and engine is different from one car to another car. So in order to understand the constraints, what I am going to do, I am going to put certain kind of assumption. So assumption is that I am assuming that car is a start from rest and a stop upon reaching the point E. It means that if they reach at this point E, then their velocity equal to zero. Now if you see same kind of things in form of mathematics, then how to do that, how to represent that? So I know that x1 whatever x1 state that represent the position and initially that equal to 0. And what is final x1? That is E. And so this I am telling that this whatever this specification that should be satisfied by that particular differential equation x1, whatever x1 equal to ax plus bu we have, so x1 dot equal to ax plus bu, and now I know what is x, I know what is u, and whatever matrix that is associated with this particular problem I am defining that as a and b. So let us just for clarification please come here, and this quantity I am telling as a, this quantity I am telling as a b. So this a is called the system matrix and this is called the input matrix. So slowly I am going to revise the all terminology which is associated with the linear control system or modern control system. After that, now you try to see that initial velocity when car is started, at that time that is also zero, and at the final point also velocity equal to zero. So if you put this particular constraint in some kind of vector, then that is called boundary condition. And what is my boundary condition? So initially you can see that x1 and x2 is zero. Now xtf, so I have to make E means x1 position as a E, but velocity as a zero. Now what I am going to do, I am going to put some more assumption because this is realistic model of car, so I have to put several restriction on that. So I am assuming that in between car is moving, so there is no breakup. Breakup means there is no certain kind of accident that is going to happen with that particular car. And due to that reason, I am assuming that x1 is going to lie between these two points and x2 velocity that is going greater than equal to 0. So this is a standard or additional constraint. Now let us try to understand constraint on the acceleration also. So actually what happens that whenever we are talking about some physical car, then I have certain observation. And what is our observation? The acceleration is bounded by some upper limit which depends on the capability of engine. So if my engine is more powerful or if my car is very good, then I can able to make acceleration that is more higher. Or our deacceleration. So I have certain kind of control system such that I am also able to deaccelerate the car in the smaller distance. And it means that I have very good braking system associated with each and every car. So this kind of observation, it means that mathematically if you try to understand this particular observation, so what we are telling that acceleration m1 that is greater than 0 and deacceleration m2 greater than 0, and in terms of the u1 and u2 I can assume that I can only able to accelerate this car from this particular limit 0 to m1, and this particular limit minus deaccelerate the car minus m2 to 0, because this is deacceleration. Due to that reason I have retained the inequality like this. So this particular thing is the restriction on the control, and I will define another terminology that is called admissible control or some notion of admissibility. It means that how much control I can able to apply. So I cannot apply any amount of control. So initially if people are exploring the control system, at that time we are assuming that I can design any control value. But slowly whenever you are talking about optimal control, at that time you have restriction on the control also. So I am telling that my control value is only lie between this particular minima to some particular maxima. Now another observation, you can see that the car start with a g gallon of gas and there is no service station on the way. So another constraint we have to put now. So what happens that I am assuming that whenever I am moving from 0 to E, in between there is no service station. It means that U1, that is acceleration factor, U1 that is responsible for the acceleration, and if you are applying higher acceleration, then what happens? I am assuming that the rate of gas consumption is proportional to the acceleration, and due to that reason I have again another factor. And what kind of factor that comes into picture? I am telling that if you want higher velocity and higher acceleration, then your gas consumption rate is higher, and due to that reason again this kind of constraint comes into picture. So now you can see that initially I have physical car, and after that, using several assumptions, several possibility, I am going to model that particular car. So I know that what is meaning of control, but here whenever we are coming to the realistic situation, then again additional terminology comes into picture. In particularly control system, that is one of the subject of applied mathematics, and due to that reason, whenever you are able to understand some small things, we are putting definition. And what is meaning of definition? That once if I put something as a definition, so same kind of meaning that is coming here and another part of world, not less than that and not more than that. And due to that reason, even if everything is understood, we are putting some kind of definition. So basically a control history which satisfies the control constraint during the entire time interval T0 to TF is called an admissible control. So here you can see that in first figure, suppose that I know that maximum value of control input is M1. So if that is less than M1, then I am telling that this is a admissible control. So even their graph is like this, and if this is less than M1, then also I am telling that as admissible control. So basically how this is different from other control area, whenever we are not talking about admissible control, so I have physical system, I know the specification, and after that we are, what is our role to design control? So basically you can see that I have some function. I have already told you that all physical system can be represented as a function, and I know the specification. So now I can define infinite many way to this input variable, such that using that input and using this system I am able to achieve that output. But whenever you have admissible control, then your search range is basically now decreased. So now in this particular example, I have to just search the control input which maximum value will lie from 0 to M1. So I cannot exceed from that, and due to that reason, that is called admissible control input. Now similarly, you can see that another thing that is associated with that is called admissible trajectory. So whenever you have car, you might have seen that they are telling that your velocity, maximum velocity, is 120 km per hour or 140 km hour. It means that always I have some specification about the trajectory which is going to generate from that particular input. So I have constraint on the trajectory also. So now I have constraint on the input and constraint on the trajectory, and this concept is called admissibility. And admissibility is one of the beautiful concept, because if I have some physical system and I know the output and I have to design input, then there is no restriction on the input or internal physical variable where that will lie. But now here I have certain kind of restriction, and I know that what type of control I can apply, what is maximum range of my trajectory or internal variable, range of internal variable, such that I can achieve certain kind of output. And due to that reason, admissibility is actually reduce the search space. So now there is no need to worry about the extra space. Just I have to search those kind of control input that is admissible, those kind of trajectory which is admissible. Now let us come to the another more important concept, and that is called performance. So you might have seen that whenever you are going to buy some car, at that time you are telling your specification to the vendor. Most of time vendor is asking your requirement. So suppose that your requirement is like this, that you have to move your car from one city to another city in some minimal time. It means that your acceleration profile or deacceleration profile should be much higher. So somehow your performance criteria is related to the minimization of time between one point to another point. So it means that whenever performance things, that is very, very subjective, and that depending on the situations. So whenever you are formulating some problem, basically you have to understand how basically you are defining the performance measure, and that is basically different, and based on the different performance measure, I have different profile of the control input one can select. So objective, to evaluate the performance of a system quantitatively. So always whenever we are talking about the performance, we have certain kind of data, and since I have to compare, so I cannot compare in higher dimension. Why I am telling that? Suppose that you have two vectors, you can take 1 and 2 and another vector like 2 and 1. So I cannot tell that this vector you can give certain name p1 and this as a p2. So I cannot tell that p1 greater than p2. I can also not able to tell that p2 is greater than p1. So this kind of things I cannot tell. But suppose if you are in one dimension space, then I can talk about the inequality. In higher dimension, you can only able to talk about the equality. And due to that reason, whenever you are defining some kind of performance measure, so you have to define some kind of quantity that map to some kind of one dimension. So you have to know certain ways such that you can map the higher dimensional problem to one dimension. And I will tell you much about the performance measure in the next class of the optimal control. So what designer always selects a performance measure, and what is role of control or somehow optimal control to minimize or maximize that performance measure. So how to maximize? Suppose that if I have some kind of fuel specification, then I want to maximize the minimize the consumption of fuel or maximize the path length. It means that using same fuel, I want to travel more distance. So somehow designer first select the performance measure, and what optimal control are doing, they try to minimize or maximize that control measure. And basically now in this particular example, whatever I have started, that example of car, so my objective that make the car reach point E as quickly as possible. So basically now my performance measure is TF minus T0, and I have to minimize this. And here you can see that this basically, since T0 is the starting time of the car, or we are telling that a starting time of the experiment, and basically, and what is TF? When I am going to reach that particular point. So when we are going to reach that particular point, it means that this again belongs to some kind of real number, and particularly this has a positive real number. So I can compare that, suppose I have two different car. So some car is taking some more time and some car is taking some less time. Then I can take that, okay, in this way, if I will move, then I can able to minimize this J. So let us again try to understand whatever I have discussed. I have system, that is car, and basically my everything is defined in this particular interval T0 to TF. I have initial value of the state, means initially I am assuming that my position and velocity equal to 0. I have two control input, that is acceleration and deacceleration, and I have certain kind of admissible trajectory. And in this particular specification, what I have to do, I have to define some kind of performance measure, and that represents some kind of unique real number to its trajectory of the system. So if you are moving from TF to T0, then I have some kind of unique number that comes into picture, and by selecting different control input, you have to minimize that. So now you are able to understand clearly that how basically optimal control problem is different from other classes of problem. So in simple control problem, I have system and I know the initial condition of the system, I know the specification, and I have to design the control input. But there is no restriction on the control input, there is no restriction on the trajectory, but here I have restriction. So basically, due to that reason, whenever you are formulating the control problem, you have to become more specific, particularly optimal control problem. So first, again, same like classical control problem, first you have to do mathematical description of the system. So basically, I have to represent that system using set of differential equation. In this course, I am going to represent system using set of differential equation or continuous differential equation or discrete differential equation. After that, I am going to clearly state the all kind of physical constraint. And after that, I am going to define the some kind of performance criteria. And by defining different performance criteria, I am going to synthesize the optimal control for that particular problem. So basically, problem is grouped in three different ways. So first, non-trivial way is the mathematical description that should be as simple as possible. Second one, I have to specify the constraint, and you know that every physical problem, I have different set of constraint, and similarly performance criteria is basically set by designers. So I have to see the performance criteria very much carefully. And what is objective of optimal control? The objective of optimal control theory is to determine the control signal that will cause a process to satisfy the physical constraint. So here one of the most important point, that in other classes of problem, we are not specifying most of time this. And at the same time, I have to minimize or maximize. So two things I have to do. If you see some classical problem, constraint is there, but I have means this second part is missing. But in optimal control design, I have to also talk about physical constraint as well as maximize or minimization of the certain kind of performance criteria. So let us try to understand the whole process mathematically. So what we are telling, that I have started with this particular system. I have already told you that we are going to represent system like this. So category of different classes of system I am going to discuss in the next class. So here what I am going to do, that I have this kind of system. Here again I am assuming that XT, that belongs to Rn, U belongs to Rm, and this F as a some kind of function. And what I am going to do, that I am going to select some kind of admissible control. I have already told you that whenever we are talking about optimal control, at that time I have to introduce the concept of admissibility. And after that, what I am telling that this particularly follow an admissible trajectory, and after that, that is going to minimize some kind of performance function. And again, now here, how to measure performance function, that is very, very subjective. And due to that reason, I have written very, very general expression. So, and I have already told you that this J belongs to some kind of positive real number. So even if I have higher dimensional space, I have to map that as a scalar one. And due to that reason, I'm assuming that H and Z, so even if X, U, both are lying on higher dimensional space, this function is going to map that in one dimension. So I will tell you that how to define this. For time being, you can just believe that basically performance measure has two part. One part is called terminal constraint, and after that, this is the another part that is related to all admissible control input as well as admissible state. Now let us come to the certain kind of remark. So what kind of difficulty basically we are facing? So we have seen that whenever we are defining optimal control problem, first or foremost, we have to understood that for some physical system, particularly optimal control exists or not. So because I have to maintain some kind of control such that all admissibility condition will satisfy, and that is not obvious. After that, I have to also make sure that whatever trajectory that system follow that admissible trajectory. Another important point, I have already told you that whenever we are talking about control, that is not unique, that is non-unique. So similar kind of non-uniqueness is also with respect to optimal control, and due to that reason, whenever something is non-unique, then actually computation process is more complicated, and due to that reason, I have several choice. So now I have to select the unique configuration, and this is the another difficulty whenever we are talking about the optimal control problem. And third one, that is basically subjected to the performance measure, I have already told you that should be minimum, and I have to select the absolute or global minima. So what is meaning of absolute and global minima? You can select any control, any profile of state trajectory, and this is the profile of optimal or admissible control or admissible trajectory that will satisfy this kind of relation. Again, this is some kind of a scalar quantity, and due to that reason, I have used this kind of inequality. So let us come to the summary of complete problem, how to solve or how to formulate the optimal control problem. So one non-trivial state, first try to select mathematical model, and mathematical model is as simple as possible. So I have selected for that particular car, I have selected this model. After that, you try to specify the boundary condition, all kind of constraint on the state or control input. And after that, you can also try to see the extra constraint. And what is extra constraint involved in this problem? That is involved in terms of the particularly the fuel of that particular car. And after that, you can able to generate the or solve the optimal control problem. So today I am not going to talk about the solution. I am just going to tell that how to formulate the optimal control problem. Now, last part is that you try to understand, and this is not the complete picture, but I am going to give you some approximate picture how basically people are solving the optimal control problem. So what I am going to assume that how to design optimal control path, optimal control problem for the automobile problem. So basically I am assuming that car has enough fuel, and after that you can see that I have two important things. I have to accelerate this car and I have to de-accelerate car. And I am assuming that whatever our acceleration power or braking power, both are same. So due to that reason, M1 and M2 both equal to M. And after that, this is the velocity profile. So what we are telling that half time, I have to accelerate very quickly. We have to reach here and same rate we have to de-accelerate here. And if you see the trajectory, then this kind of trajectory comes into picture. So in the next part of this course, we are going to see that why this kind of basically trajectory or this kind of admissible trajectory comes into picture. So now what we have learned during this particular class, that how to formulate the optimal control problem, how optimal control problem is different from the classical problem. In classical problem, most of time we are not talking about constraint, we are not talking about some kind of performance measure, and but here we are involving everything, and somehow this world is based on optimality. So due to that reason, we have to also talk about the optimal control. So due to that reason, whenever you are designing or thinking thinking about some new system, try to involve the optimal design, try to involve the optimal control. So with this remark, I'm going to stop the today's lecture. So thank you very much.